uncompromising, addictive, and often unforgiving, with an adrenaline rush like no other. There is no practice, no second chances. It's the ultimate motorsport competition on gravel. It is Rally, and this is the East Coast Bull Bars Australian Rally Championship. It's round three of the National Championship and round three of the Asia Pacific Regional Championship, coming to you from the Sunshine Coast. In today's program, the dogfight continues between Polaris and Can-Am in the Australian side-by-side series. The Turbo Maverick certainly has the pace to match the Razor, but how important will reliability be this round? Neil Bates will wheel spanners rather than steering this round, pitching in to help son Harry and Molly Taylor in the outright category, leaving Clay Badenoch to lead the classic battle. A battle that Tony Quinn, for one, intends taking right up to him. And of course, we'll feature the Armorall STP Power Stage. The Outright Championship and Four-Wheel Drive National Series both have a chance to gain early points.
So it's our third power stage for the series here in Queensland, and it should be very exciting. Four-wheel drive field, of course, got the maxi car back of Mark Pedder. Expecting big things from him after his dramas in Canberra. Series leader Mick Patton in the Repco car. What a year he's had so far, but hasn't made a power stage start. And lots of locals from Queensland that'll give him a hard time. The outright's what we're excited about, though. The battle here should be amazing. A true forest run on our power stage. And, of course, the tantalising battle between the Evans brothers. We saw it in Canberra. Wasn't quite a fair fight with Simon having some issues. What will happen here? Our championship leader in outright, the same as four-wheel drive, hasn't made a qualifying run here. Molly Taylor hasn't made it through. More points for her campaign would be a real plus. Sullins has been on the fringe and been very fast on the last couple of events. Coppins made every single power stage so far. McKenzie struck out on most of them. So lots going on, lots to talk about. And one of the big things that everyone is worried about, of course, is these road conditions. Lots of rain here in Queensland, which is going to make it very tricky on these stages. Very cresty, blind corners, and that's what they're going to be worried about as they transverse through this very difficult stage.
Outright and four-wheel drive teams have that chance to grab some early points. But with only three places on offer, competition will be tight to make the final. And with just one qualifying run, there are no second chances. The final face-off will determine who grabs an extra 5 points. Last round in Canberra, Eli was on the money, edging his brother Simon out for the top spot with Adrian Coppin third. Justin Dowell was eyeing off a win in the new Proto, but the unrestricted cars of Marcus Walkham and Richie Dalton would pay to that, the Irishman coming out on top in spectacular style. There's been nothing sunshine about the weather on the coast this week, and the power stage had to be hastily changed twice due to road conditions, the last as late as last night after officials finally agreed it had to change. This new track, the reverse of a road used in testing, is still muddy in places and will provide a real mix of road surface and condition for the Armorall STP Power Stage. It's a drag strip to start up Armorall straight to the first split at Can-Am Climb, veering left up through the mud into the trees. Weaving their way uphill and down, cars will emerge out onto a ridge that leads to the second split at Polaris. The STP speed trap will find out just who's fastest down over the Coates Hire hump and back to the final zigzag through to the finish. We've led former Australian rally champion Neil Bates behind the wheel of the ECB FJ Cruiser to check it out and tell us what it's really like.
So we have our four times Australian champion Neil Bates in here on the East Coast Bull Bars car on the STP and Armorall Power Stage. And Neil, you've been throwing the duties. What is it like out there? It looks pretty slippery from here.
Yeah, look, it's very, very slippery. It's really, really nice to start with. It's fast flowing, really the sort of roads I like. And then you turn into the forest and it's just such a change of character. It's really narrow, really slippery, and there's two distinct wheel tracks that you've got to stay in those wheel tracks. And, you know, there's just slop on the outside of that with a, you know, you go up to the top of the hill and then there's a really tricky right-hander that's, once again, just two wheel tracks. Get out of them and you'll see the seconds tick by. But, you know, when you get out of there, it's really grippy around the top and then really fast downhill. And, you know, that'll really suit the front-wheel drive cars. You know, the only The only disadvantage front-wheel drive cars will have is going up the hill, but my bet is a front-wheel drive car will be faster.
Well, that's what we're going to see. And, of course, qualifying, they get one pass of qualifying, Rusty, to get into this STP and Armoral Power Stage. Before I throw to you, Neil, you didn't know part of the gig, mate, but there's the Armoral product. You need you went out there,
no,
you got it, money. You have
guys,
to watch it. You can sort that while we go to the highlights.
In the mix-up of last-minute changes in the last 24 hours, organisers allowed four-wheel drive entrant Kent Lawrence out onto the track earlier to take corporate rides. And unfortunately, that means he knows the road better than his opposition. So he's been deemed ineligible for the 5 bonus points, despite setting the second fastest time. No blistering time being set by the Repco team either after Mick Patton jumped the start. He and Bernie gave up the fight there and then. Mr. Fibertech Medical himself, Gerald Schofield, pushed hard though to record third fastest time and his first appearance in the Armoral STP Power Stage, along with Michael Bailey in the BP Ultimate entry, driving a similar Mitsubishi Evo 9. Mark Pedder, though, who continued to practice hard in the new Pedder suspension Peugeot maxi car, taking every opportunity to put it through its paces. So, the final is Gerald Schofield, Michael Bailey and Mark Pedder in the hunt for bonus points in the Armoral STP Power Stage. And a surprise entry. Catch that right after the break. Welcome back to the East Coast Bull Barns Australian Rally Championship being held on the Sunshine Coast. The weather's cleared for our Armoral STP Power Stage and our four-wheel drive finalists are ready to go. But before we see that, we decided to award Kent Lawrence a wildcard entry despite being ineligible for points. His time was good enough to qualify, so he's on the start line with Dean right now.
Kent Lawrence, our wildcard here in the four-wheel drives, mate. A few corporate rides meant you were ineligible, but second fastest going good around here, mate.
Yeah, look, we're having a great time. So, yeah, so we did a couple of corporate runs this morning, so maybe gave us a little bit of a sighting. But, yeah, no, it was good fun. It's good to know we got the pace.
What are the conditions like out there? Tell us. We just heard from Neil Bates. He reckons it's pretty greasy. You're in the hot seat here.
Oh, look, it's always going to be a bit wet, right? We've had a lot of rain. So drive to the conditions, but it's not as bad if you stay online. It gets a bit slippery if you get off.
Well, looking good, guys. Hang in there. We can't wait to see you run.
Thanks, Dean. Great stuff.
5 seconds. 4.
This is a bit of a benchmarking process for this team. They want to make a full assault on the championship in 2016. He's underway.
Straight 80. 6 left up. Slippy.
New co-driver for this event, James Wilson, who's worked with Clay Badenoch, has come on board. James is also service for Molly Taylor over time.
80, through dip, 50, 4 left mud.
Mission is to get to the end of the rally, so they want to keep it tidy. Through the Can-Am split, and that is our benchmark sector time that will refer to our reference point for the coming runs. Look at it up here on the uphill run, how slushy, how tough it is.
5 left over slight crest, 80 braking, 4 right over crest, muddy. 80.
This team on Kumho tyres for the first time. They've been running a different brand in the Queensland Championship, so they've needed to make a setup adjustment to learn that, the nuances of these tyres.
6 right up, 50. 4 left over crest, keep in, 50.
Drier here. You can see the surface, a bit more open.
3 over crest, then 3 left, keep out.
Coming up to that second split, Polaris.
Over brown. 6 right. 50.
Neil Bates talked about it in the lead-up. The tracks, keeping the car on those tram tracks. 140 kilometres an hour at the 6 STP
left,
radar marker. The speed
3
trap.
Left, braking into 3 right up over flying finish.
Just trying to arrest that speed. Into that left-hander. So there's the time, a 1:39.
Rusty, I'm loving this loop stage. I can walk from the start to the finish here. Kent, how was your run there, mate? You're back at the other end?
Oh, look, it was pretty good. It was maybe a little bit slippery than the last one, actually. I don't know whether we got offline or whatever, but it was a bit of fun. So.
Well, that can happen, and our lead teams will have to keep that in mind. The surface can slip up a little bit. You know, the water comes to the top, doesn't it? So you found it pretty slippy on that run.
Yeah, no, it was a little bit slipperier, but maybe it was just nerves as well, so who knows, eh?
and maybe a little bit of a want to ensure that it was conservative for this run. It's important that he gets to the end of this rally. That's the mission. Great that these guys have had a run in the power stage. Okay, the first of our three four-wheel drive finalists are ready to go. Dean?
Gerald Schofield, his first run at a power stage here, Gerald. And how are the nerves going, mate?
Yeah, the nerves are getting going now, mate. It's very slippery in there, as you know, and there's quite a few bumps that I didn't realise in the recce. So, yeah, I'm looking forward to it this time.
So you think a little bit more wild the first pass, or are you going to be more calm this time? What's going on in your head?
I don't know. I'll let you know when I get there.
Good luck with it, Rusty. He's not giving anything away, but can't wait to see this car fire through the forest.
Me too, Dino. He said to us in the lead-up that this kind of stage is what he's used to from his time in the UK. A bit slippery, a bit wet, suits his driving style.
50, keep right over crest, 100. Long left, 5.
Remember at the previous event in Canberra, had trouble with the head gasket. They've worked on that engine in the break between rounds. It's a well-sorted Evo 9, this one.
100.
And it's a good advantage at the Can-Am split. Over a second that he's up in those tram tracks. Look at the car.
It's a left 5.5, 50.
And actually began life as a tarmac racer, this car. Campaigned by Rod Salmon to a win at the Bathurst 12 hour.
Slippy, open. Then tight to 5. It's a left 4.50.
They run the 6-speed sequential Hollinger box.
Right over crest, 50.
Which Gerald feels makes life a lot easier. Right, they can keep it on the boost through the bends, pull another gear.
Left 4 over crest, 50. Left 4 longish, tightens.
Voice you're listening to, Katrina. First time for this pairing working together.
Right,
she's from Queensland, and the combo's going well. Look at the advantage here now at the Polaris split.
Right 6 over, right crest.
137 kilometres an hour, not quite as fast as Kent, but only 3k's an hour off it at the trap.
Into right 3 through finish.
Tidy through the left-hander. We head to the line here now. He's up. Lost a little time in the final sector.
That was good. I enjoyed that.
Gerald, I detected you're a bit nervous at the start of that one. How are you feeling at the end?
I'm even more nervous now.
It's over though. How did it go for you?
Yeah, no, it was good. I'm really looking forward to tomorrow now. The car's going awesome, and the guy's done a great job since Canberra. So, yeah, I'm really looking forward to it.
So, Katrina, Kelly making the calls as we take a look at the Kumo replay, and you heard the jolt, the jarring landing at this point. And he winced, didn't he? Happy with the run. So Gerald Schofield takes his place in the Armorall STP staging area. Michael Bailey is now on the start line.
Michael Bailey, a local guy here, mate, in the power stage. Must be pretty keen to get out there.
Yeah, no, it's after Canberra's disappointment. We're keen to get back in the forest and give it a good red hot go.
Everyone's gone a little bit quicker. Gerald did a really great time, a sub 140. You think you can match him in through here?
It's going to be a ding-dong battle between the big man and me this weekend. So, no, we're going to give it a real go. And also balance it off. We don't want to take home a bent car to the boys at lunchtime today.
Sure enough, but I like your first attitude, mate. Go get him.
Yeah, we'll go for it.
The reference to Canberra there. They had an incident. Last round, blew an engine. New engine for this event. Very professional outfit. Let's keep this in balance. They're still getting up to speed in some respects. Nice start.
Round 9 right, 50. 7 left over crest, very long hug. 7 left, very long hug.
It's an ex-Rally Art car, built in Australia, this one. Owned by Justin Dowell at one point, the ex-Australian champion.
Left in, double, mud.
Five up to the Can-Am split.
Mud. Bump on exit.
Caution, very cautious through that bump there. And he's down, you can see 2 seconds off Schofield's marker at the first sector.
7 left. 7 left over crest in. Into caution break, 4 right hug over crest mud.
Like I said, really important to build confidence in this car. To get the best out of it, he feels you've got to drive it at 9 to 10 tenths.
7 left down, into 10 right over crest, through dip. 9 right up, 50. 9 right up, 50. 5 left over crest in, 50.
You can see the difference in the surface. The weather's cut it up a bit, the wet weather in the lead-up. But once you get over the hill here, it clears. Look at the surface now. The second split to Polaris.
Nine right. fast, 9 right, 50.
There's not much of a gain there. 50. He's still down relative eight to right Schofield. Rail, it looks tiny, though.
9 left.
Nothing in it. In the comparison at the STP speed trap, he's only a kilometre an hour off the speed we saw from Schofield. Oh, trying to slow the car down for the left-hander.
Into three right up. And
tight line through there. He actually recovers some time in the final sector, but not enough to beat Schofield.
How's your run in there, Michael? How'd you feel?
Big fella's got us, but anyway, long weekend to go.
What a great run, though. It's a fascinating stage through here, isn't it? Real intense and a good little battle.
Very technical, very technical. So well done to Jared. Well done to him.
Great sporting stuff there. And if we look at this overall on the Kumo replay, he was wise to be cautious in that first part, but then extended the legs as the stage went on and continued to improve. He wrestled some of that time back, but not enough to win. Gerald Schofield safe for the moment, but the Pedder suspension Peugeot 208 is waiting on the line. We'll have that in just a few moments. You're watching the East Coast Bull Bars Australian Rally Championship coming to you from the hinterland on Queensland's Sunshine Coast. Dean Herridge is with our fastest qualifier in the Armorall STP Power Stage.
So our fastest qualifiers for four-wheel drive is Mark Pedder and Dale Moskett. Unbelievable job in the great-sounding maxi car. Look at the smile on your face. It says it all.
Yeah, no, it was a reasonable first run. We took it fairly conservatively, but I think that might be the key, Dino, up over the top when it's nice and wet. But yeah, no, it's a nice clean run.
And how is it after Canberra, of course, debut run for this car, nothing but trouble. Lots of work being done by the crew, and it seems to be going great now, mate.
Yeah, look, mate, we did a really good two-day test last week and then did another test on Wednesday here. So fingers crossed we've got it all sorted, and now we can just start playing to make it a little bit faster.
Well, the guys are going quicker. 139.2. Gerald Schofield set the benchmark. Do you think you can nail that?
Well, we'll wait and see, mate. We'll have a crack and see what we can do.
Huge potential in this car, and as Mark pointed out there, they were racing against time at the last round of the championship to get that new engine in, so they're constantly developing.
100 in long, 10 left on brow, 120.
Listen to the calm voice of Dale Moskett in the co-driver's seat. He's spending so much time match fit in co-driving terms at the moment, working with Scott Pedder on his international program, and Mark here in the Australian Championship. Against Schofield's marker, he's up at the first sector and quick through there too.
Good seven left, 20. Caution, four right on crest, slippy.
Car looks tidy on the road, doesn't it? Very stable.
Yeah, short, seven right on brow.
Through Kumo, and we head toward the Polaris split now, the second split. Surely he's been able to build on the number we saw there before. Attacking, look at Pedder. Gritting the teeth, he's into this.
On crest. 20.
A little wide.
Three left, rough.
Using the road.
50.
Oh, it's a huge advantage for Mark Pedder. What a drive.
Slow eight left.
138 kilometres an hour, the speed, it's about on par with what we've seen from the front runners in this stage so far. All trying to get back down through the gears, sideways through there. Look at the time. It's a ripper from Mark Pedder and Dale Moskett.
I'll have a sip of Supreme if you're making pizza.
Thanks, mate. That was might be a little bit deep into that last quarter.
Well done.
Mate, how did your run go?
Nice and clean until the end, and we nearly stuck it off the road. So, yeah, I'm not sure how much time we dropped, but it would have been a little bit. It's great to be able to bring this out after all the dramas in Canberra and have a great run and sort of half prove what the car can do.
It was fantastic. This is what he was talking about here. All hands on the wheel, trying to get the car turned to slow it down. And it almost went pear-shaped, carrying too much speed through that left-hander, but it did not hurt the time. Spectacular stuff from Mark Pedder and Dale Moskett. Top spot and five bonus points for the Pedder suspension team. Well done.
Mark Pedder, Dale Moskett, congratulations, mate, four-wheel drive. Your first power stage win, I think, too.
It is, mate. Yeah, been a long time coming, but look, great to get this thing out, get it running right, and, you know, starting to prove what the new maxi car formula can do. So, no, really good run.
Pretty exciting machine to be in, isn't it?
Yeah, look, it's a great package, and you know the plus for us is in the drier sections in that stage, which we're hoping the rest of the rally will be like. The car was fantastic, so yeah, looking forward to the event.
A great start to what is really their first full outing with the new Peugeot Maxi car.
Neil Bates, we've seen the four-wheel drives go through this very tricky stage. Good job by all the crews, though.
Yeah, look, it was very good. Very good to see Mark Pedder and Dale Moscott in the new Maxi car, and you know, they've had a very tough time, obviously, in Rally of Canberra, and see them win the power stage here is just absolutely fantastic. You know, couldn't be happier for them.
It looks the part and goes sensational. Now we move on to outright cars. We're going to do the qualifying in a second. You said earlier on that you thought the outrights could do a pretty good job through here.
Yeah, look, I reckon they can be a match for the four-wheel drive cars. I just think that the downhill stuff, tough braking, you know, it's quite tight. You know, the outright cars are more nimble, lighter, so I think that, you know, there's some places where they'll have an advantage, but obviously the four-wheel drive cars up the hill, you know, they can rock it up there.
They'll have to be very aggressive to get these times, won't they?
They'll be aggressive, definitely.
That's what he said. We're going to go to the highlights of outright cars. Rusty, over to you.
Thanks, guys. Clutch dramas for Adrian Coppen robbed him of a chance of a third straight finals appearance. But Molly Taylor was consistent. Once again, our championship leader failed to make the final, almost 2 seconds off the pace required to make the cut. Steve McKenzie was clipping corners and trees in a bid to make his first final, but he too fell short. 1 full second split the two work Citroens, with Eli Evans ahead, Tony Sullins the final qualifier. But it was Eli's brother Simon who had the fastest time in the Tankformers Honda Jazz. Another second faster than the Citroen. So, Tony Sullins, Eli Evans and Simon Evans are about to face off in the Armorall STP Power Stage. All that when we return in just a few moments. Welcome back to the East Coast Bull Bars Australian Rally Championship, coming to you from the Sunshine Coast in Queensland. Our third fastest qualifier in the Armorall STP Power Stage is on the line with our Dean Herridge.
Tony Sullins and Julia Barclay making it into the final. Well done, guys. Good job through a very tricky stage.
Yeah, thank you. It's a bit challenging out there, but we had a bit of a go, and I did a few little suspension tweaks, so it might be reasonably better next time.
So you're dialing it in to try and meet the conditions a little bit, because you were in the mix on times.
Yeah, I guessed what we might need, and I guess wrong. It's drier on the top than what I thought it was going to be, and it's a bit bouncy, so I've put a bit of a rebound in it.
We talked about it in camera, mate. With those Go Fast glasses on, you're probably a big chance, I reckon.
Oh, I hope so, yeah.
Good luck.
Thank you.
Nice work, Dean. He feels the straight line nature of this course will suit his smooth driving style. Not as aggressive as Simon and Eli Evans. But that suspension change he talked about there with Dean will be critical. Will it help him?
Very long over crest.
Just felt he needed that rebound to settle it down.
50, dip, and left five slipping.
The very experienced 30. Julia Barclay calling there.
Short flat, left six over crest.
That's our marker.
Two, left five and a half, narrow.
Hit some of the four-wheel drive times there before. That's a great effort short for a front-wheel drive. Tony Sullins.
Short left five and a half, into early right four over crest, slippy out. Four and a half.
Trees are so close to the road in this part of the track. Bit daunting at times.
And stay right flat crest. Into dip. Into right five and a half. Into don't cut left four and a half over crest. And left four and a half hug.
As we head to the second split here, worth remembering too that this car, compared to Adrian Coppen and Eli Evans, runs a taller diff ratio. Look at that, 1 minute 13.85 so far.
Over crest.
Still not on the road.
Short left five.
146 kilometres an hour. That's the quickest we've seen so far at the STP Speed Trap. Good job.
Into a right four bump over finish.
Tidy for the final run to the finish line. A 35.98 laid down for the front-wheel drive cars.
Yeah, it wasn't much quicker.
Yeah, well, I got a 136 that time.
Okay. Well, so maybe.
I reckon it was quicker. Okay. It felt quicker to me anyway.
Yeah, I was having a bit of a go, but
So you are 3 seconds fast, which is pretty good through here in these conditions.
Yeah.
Julia's nodding her head, she's happy.
Yeah, I was pretty happy. Much faster than that in this car, I'm going to knock it around. So.
Do you think it's enough to hold off the Evans brothers?
Eli's car's a bit higher, and I think he'll push harder on that on the bottom of the Audi stuff, and Simon's a nutcase, so the short answer is no.
Let's take a look at the Kumo replay here, and this is what he's saying about he's a tidy driver by nature, but just a little offline there as he chases and pushes for time.
Eli Evans and Glenn Weston's our power stage winners at the last round. Qualified second in here, and I've got to say, Tony's put a good time in there. He's 3 seconds, a whole 3 seconds quicker than his first run. So, it's either gripping up or he's had a big go. What do you think?
Yeah, I think that's pretty impressive. So, Tony's obviously had a real dip through there. So, he's set the bar now. So, I've got no choice but to go flat out. And I know the big gorilla behind me is going to do the same thing. So,
you're referring to the gorilla, of course, your brother. You're the only one game enough to say that. But it is. It's worked out that top two qualifiers. We spoke about it in Canberra. You got on top. But you know, his car looks pretty strong here, doesn't it?
Yeah, look, they've rebuilt the engine from Canberra again. So, you know, it's a fast car. I've raced it. I raced 2 years in it. We didn't lose one event in it. It's a phenomenal little car. But I'm on the Citroen now. This is up for the job, and we're going to give it everything we've got for here and make sure we get the 5 points.
You love this stuff, don't you?
Oh, I love talking to you, Dino. You get me excited. Now I've got to calm myself down. I've got about a minute before we start, so get out.
Oh, and I'll see you at the end this time too, by the way. Good luck.
Five. Nice work. Eli and Glenn Weston set to go. Let's watch the way this car launches off the line relative to Tony Sullins. We were saying before about Sullins running that taller ratio. So Evans' car, by comparison, launches quicker.
Fast left eight.
Very tidy so far.
70.
It feels as though there's been a big improvement in his driving with this car. Completely different to what he's been used to in recent time in championship terms. Little sideways there. He has an advantage, albeit a slight one. Over Tony Sullins, look at that, he's in trouble there. Somehow keeps it out of the greenery.
Short left 7. 50, short left 7, care.
Wow, that got the heart rate going.
Short left 7, care, right 6, over crest, line clean, slippy.
Then low down torque of this car, paddle shift as well.
Left 7.
And Eli really feels it suits him, suits his style.
Crest 50, short right 7, short left 5 over crest, then care left 4.
Because of the rules, they can get about a season and a half out of the engine. They can't really touch anything engine-wise. It's a very good package. Polaris split. He's down, though. He's lost some time in that middle sector relative to Sullins. This is good for Tony Sullins and Julia Barclay. What can he do? 142 kilometres an hour. At the trap.
Fast left 4 through 1. Right 3 finish.
Trying to maintain that speed through the final left-hander. Let's look at the time. He recovers. He recovers. Eli Evans goes back to the top. What a stage.
35 flat.
I tried to take it as fast as I could. But have a go though.
I wouldn't expect anything less.
I think he knows something. He's smiling. What's going on in this car?
We just went flat out and, like, coming off the fast section in sixth gear, went down to fourth and turned off the main road and went through the first ruts, popped out of the second, did this big tank slap, nearly spun it down the road. But I just kept the Citroen buried, climbed back onto the road and we kept going. We've beaten Tony, but I don't know.
You're out of breath, mate.
We were laughing so hard. I can't believe we made it through. But, look, I gave it absolutely everything I had. If I had it pulled off, we might have got it into 34, so it's up to Simon now. I'm glad we beat Tony, but it was pretty messy, but I had a lot of fun.
It's his sixth consecutive year in front-wheel drive, and all that experience kicks in at this marker. Rear end bottoms out, steps out sideways, gets on the gas and recovers, and somehow keeps it out of the trees. Well done. Doesn't even raise a sweat. Citroen out, Citroen in. But can they remain in the top spot? Has Eli left the door open for his brother Simon? We'll find out in just a few moments. Welcome back to the Armorall STP Power Stage from the East Coast Bull Bars Australian Rally Championship in Queensland. Dean Herridge is on the start line with our quickest qualifier in outright two-wheel drive.
Fastest qualifiers are Simon Evans and Ben Searcy in the Honda, mate. Great job in qualifying, but this is the one that counts.
Yeah, exactly. It's time to get my job on now and have some fun. But I tell you what, the little Honda Jazz is a fantastic car.
Now, the thing is, you're going to have to beat your brother. He did a 35-1, so it's a pretty good time. Now, Tony Sullins, when he got to the end, called you a lunatic, and on the start line, your brother called you a gorilla. Now, without my words, does that fire up, or you're just a water off a duck's back?
From the sounds of it, they're pretty apt descriptions, so it's time to get my crazy on.
Crazy on. It's one of those stages, though. It's a bit of all or nothing, isn't it?
Yeah, absolutely. And look, the road's really coming to the, you know, to the car, so Every run is getting grippier and grippier, and I'm looking forward to getting out there and doing the best I can.
Mate, I normally ask people how they're going to attack it. I know how you're going to do it, and we can't wait to watch, mate. Good luck.
Thanks very much.
Love the personality. Love the fact that our Dean Herridge is stirring the drivers up to at the start line. Nice work.
100.
Listen to the Jazz rev. Brand new motor after Canberra. This team have built it in-house. They've been searching for more torque. And Evans is really happy based on the run so far. He is attacking Simon Evans.
Fast, left two, slippery, rough. Doubles. 100.
Then Searcy guiding him through. He's down by a fraction relative to his brother. Almost steps out in the same fashion. Not quite as violent. And he keeps that foot buried.
1.5 long. Then a turn. Fast right two, sharp on crest. Stay in. Stay in. 50.
Because the testing was so wet, he feels that this run over the power stage, in some respects, is the first proper one. He said, we are going to attack this.
100. Right, 100. Fast right one long. Fast right one long. Then fast left 2.5. Late on crest. 50. Fast left 2.5.
So much experience that he brings to the table in this sport. He said, you've got to keep it tidy, keep it on the island where the grip is. Don't go wide. Well, you be the judge. He's up at the Polaris split, but he's using every ounce of the road. It's great to watch. 144 kilometres an hour. That is very telling at the STP speed trap. It looks fast, and he's carrying the speed. No! He misses out just by 0.2 of a second, all in the final sector.
That was a little messy.
Wow. That was some serious driving.
It sure was serious.
Let's see what they get us at.
Now, it's close. Eli here wants to see the official times too, to find out who the winner is.
35.3, you've missed it on the board by 0.2, you've been robbed, mate.
Been absolutely robbed at the line, buddy.
0.2.
Tried so hard, so.
Pretty exciting from that point of view with these stages. Now, rallying's about being quick all the time, but over a period of time, over a long day. Here, 2 kilometres, give it your best. You and your brother, 0.2 apart, it's awesome.
Yeah, mate, that's what rallying's about. We have to get him in the forest now.
So we take a look, down by a fraction at the end of the first sector, powers up the hill, keeps the accelerator mashed to the floor at that point. Not quite as full on the tank slapper as his brother. Gets ahead in the middle sector and then drops a little at the end. There you have it, the Evans fight ends with Eli on top for a second time. That's as good as it gets in a power stage final.
I can't believe it. I want to see Simon's run. I think it would have been fairly interesting, but super pumped. I gave it everything we had, absolutely everything, and this time it paid off. So we've got to continue this run for the weekend.
Very well done.
Thank you very much.
Congratulations, Eli.
From a champion himself.
Champions indeed. Right now, it's time for those champions of the past, the rear-wheel drive classics. Will Tony Quinn clean up? With Neil Bates and Coral Taylor concentrating on servicing for their respective kids this weekend, Clay Badenoch was left to fly the flag for Toyota. But it wasn't a cakewalk. The pet food turned chocolate baron was on his hammer from SS1.
I think you'll find Quinny had chocolate for breakfast because he got me by 0.2 in that one.
It was game on for the game over BMW. Tony Quinn was on it all right. And he took time out of the Celica RA40 through the first two stages. The other Celica of Chris Harbeck was not in that fight, keeping clear of the flak between the two frontrunners. The longer stage, Speedy Contractors, was where Badenoch extracted revenge, pulling out the stops to beat Quinn by a second a kilometre over the 22 Ks. Quinn was back on top for the first repeat, but pushed too hard through SS6 and broke a drive shaft. He pushed on and broke the other drive shaft.
Brilliant. No matter how bad a weekend you're having, it's better than visiting Harvey Norman again.
We've lost Tony on the stage before this one.
Yep.
And there's only clay in front of us, so we'll keep the old girl plugging along, hopefully.
But Harbeck found himself in water wars through the repeat of Speedy at the creek crossing, flooding the car and ending his weekend early. Quinn was back in the fight with Badenoch in Heat 2, the lead seesawing between the pair. Again, the longer stage fell in favour of the Toyota, but in frustration, Quinn decided he should concentrate for the repeat stage. The result saw him take 4 seconds out of his opponent over the 22Ks. It was all a little too late, though, and the two-horse race fell in favour of Clay Badenoch. No Neil Bates on the podium this round, but still, a Celica RA40 continued the reign on the top step of that classic podium. There's another two-horse race coming up right after the break, the Australian side-by-side challenge, and the battle between Polaris and Can-Am. That's next. Round two of the side-by-side challenge brought renewed enthusiasm from Michael Guest, whose new turbocharged Maverick XDS was a shot in the arm for him and Can-Am.
Flat right, small dip, 30. Fast medium right over crest, Titans minus. Into fast medium left and danger break to a fast K right.
Former rally champion Cody Crocker was in trouble from the start. The Polaris pilot had been struggling, as it was, to keep pace with the new power of the Maverick. A flat through the opening stage dropped him to fourth. Michael Guest claiming the opening bout. Nathan Shivers didn't have the speed of the sister Maverick. The recent Fink Desert race had taken its toll on all those who'd entered, and the Anglomoil machine was suffering from grooves worn into the clutch, preventing it getting full speed.
Into 9 left, 10 right, Brown, 50.
Through Candanga, Crocker responded with a win. Guest had suffered a broken exhaust. Another hangover from the grueling Fink experience. That leak meant a loss of power, and with that came a loss of lead. But for this little off, Ian Hughes would likely have beaten both Guest and his teammate Crocker. Midday service fixed the exhaust issue for Can-Am, and Guest and David Green were out again in the afternoon, claiming the checkered flag every stage. The disadvantage of no windscreen becomes obvious through creek crossings, but the increase in water flow between the repeat stages catches the side-by-side field. Still, a decisive win to Michael Guest.
We've taken a few out of Cody then, I think nearly 4 seconds, which is good, so yeah, we just keep plugging away at it.
No tyre issues for Crocker's second run, but water was an issue.
For some reason, it's wetter than this morning, so we hit the water splash, which was just a dip, rocky dip earlier, and today, now it's wet, so we copped a bit of that. I don't know how Greg's notes went.
His co-driver's pace notes might have copped a drenching, but teammate Ian Hughes' co-pilot, David Piper, was thinking ahead. The number two Polaris home and hosed in second.
Yeah, a little bit of a miss in the engine. I think it's bad fuel left over from Fink. So it's slowly starting to work out and it's coming good, so yeah.
It wasn't good though. Hughes and Piper pulled the pin next stage, electing not to risk damaging their engine. With Can-Am up, Heat 2 brought quiet optimism in the Maverick camp, but the exhaust issue of Heat 1 still lingered.
Fast speedy right, plus half long, 150.
Every crack meant lost exhaust flow, and the turbo requires that flow to make its exceptional power. Guest and David Green came out of the blocks with a clear win in the long, speedy North stage. Same as Heat 1, just reversed. The exhaust broke next stage, and the XDS Maverick was once again off song.
Yeah, I started off brilliantly. We had a great win on the first stage this morning, confident, and then bang, the exhaust broke, which is a leftover issue, I reckon, from Fink Desert Race. So it was only boys had a two-day turnaround to get from Alice Springs all the way back down to South Australia into Canberra, turn this car around and get it up here for the rally. And I reckon that's what's costing us a little bit at the moment. Nathan Shivers and the other Mavericks had a broken exhaust in the same spot, and I reckon it's just the sheer punishment of Fink that's done it.
New Million is an old favourite for Cody Crocker. It's a rough track, skirting up and around the edge of the forest with some big drops. This year, there was an even bigger drop that would reward the brave. Crocker from Guest by 15 seconds. By the end of the next stage, Woodlands, Nathan Shivers' exhaust was out in sympathy with Guest's, both Mavericks lagging behind the Razor. Service and a welder couldn't come soon enough.
We are 35 seconds behind, four stages to go. Can I get there? I don't know, we'll have to wait and see.
Armour all, glass cleaner.
Crocker might have been wishing for a windscreen to clean, but he was now showing his opposition a clean pair of heels.
Yeah, today's a good day. I guess he's actually having a slight problem with his exhaust or something, so we're going to capitalise on that. We've got a 35 second lead, I think, so now we're going back into the stages again to repeat them. We've got to try and hold on to that, so I think he's going to be coming back fiercely, so we'll do what we can, but it's full attack for the rest of the day.
And attack he did, but so too did Guest. With the exhaust repaired, he was 8 seconds up on Crocker at the halfway point, but the pressure was too much. The clutch belt let go, and their horsepower advantage over the Polaris was slashed to only manpower. Two, in fact, as Guest and Green had to push to the stage finish, ending their round early. Nathan Shivers had returned, but he was never a threat to Crocker, suffering the same lack of power issues. Shivers was happy just to make the podium, leaving Crocker the victor in round two. Stay tuned next week for all the action from the main competition in the East Coast Bull Bars Australian Rally Championship. Hope you can join us. In the meantime, keep up with all the latest news at rally.com.au. Till next time, I'm Greg Rust. Bye for now.
Today's coverage is made possible by Kumo Tyre, Pedder Suspension, Armour, STP, Co-Tyre, Can-Am, Polaris, and our supporting partner, East Coast Bull Bars, world's best alloy bull bars.